Welcome to HCAM News. Tom Nappy at the anchor desk to keep you up to date with everything you need to know about Hopkinton. Some of the many brilliant minds at Hopkinton High School showed off some of their work at the annual Science and Engineering Fair. This year, 28 projects were on display, and the 12 winning projects got the chance to qualify for the regional Science and Engineering Fair. Here's a look at some of the many great projects.
Okay, so for our project, we did the durability of long-lasting lipsticks, and what we did was we realized that the annual revenue of the cosmetic industry is $56,875,000 a year. We also found that 56,000 employees work in the cosmetic industry, and 58% of people ages 8 to 18 wear makeup, so it's a huge part of our world today. We also, our whole project is based on waxes, which are in our lipsticks. So the Kat Von D lipstick has sunflower seed wax, which we found was the most, the strongest and most durable wax in all of these lipsticks. What this wax does is it's made from sunflower seed oil, which is used as a lipid to make the lipsticks tight and like makes the lipsticks really colorful and bright. And it's also an emollient, which helps a lot. It moisturizes your lips. So what we did was we ran two kinds of tests. We ran
one test, and it was our shower simulator test, which we simulated a shower by putting our makeup doll with the lipstick on underneath the faucet of the sink and held it for 1 minute. After the minute, we wiped the doll with a paper towel that simulated a washcloth. To measure like the difference in like the difference of the lipsticks, we used this color scale to start with one color and after the test get to another color.
So after we got all of our data, which you can see here, we ran t-tests, which tell you if the numbers you got are significantly different or not, and we realized the comparison within these lipsticks show that these lipsticks are significantly different. What we found is the Kat Von D, which is the most expensive, is also the best lipstick, so it is worth its money. And our final conclusion was that sunflower seed wax is the best wax to use in lipstick. And the Sephora lipstick was the worst, and it had beeswax in it. And it was in the middle of our price range, so it was a little bit disappointing to find out that it did not work as well as it should.
All right, and how long did this all take you?
We decided our idea in September, October. We got approval to start testing in late December, and we started testing early February. The testing took us 2 to 3 days because it wasn't like that bad. Yeah, but like it was very quick, but we got a lot of data from the short time, so it was
So I'm Abby Kelly Lancer, and I did my science fair project on music and language. I wanted to find the relationship between the two, And so I tested participants with an artificial grammar test. It's basically a letter flow chart, and I tested them for their memorization skills and pattern recognition, which are good components of language learning. I correlated those test scores with survey responses. So I asked them, how many instruments do you play, which ones, how long have you been taking them for, and the same thing with languages, which languages, etc. And so the results I got were that generally participants who took more instruments, who know how to play more instruments, they got higher test scores. So music helps you learn languages.
All right, terrific. And how long did this take you?
So Science Verse starts at the beginning of the year, so we do research in like September, October, November, and we start getting together our experiments and we start experimenting December, January, and then you have to put it all together into the project, so it's taken the whole year.
So my project this year revolved around trying to create an automatic hand washing machine. I've done a lot of research and found that a lot of people really don't know how to wash their hands correctly, or in even worse scenarios, they don't know how to wash their hands at all. So my project revolved around trying to create a prototype that would help make the streamline the process of hand washing more simpler for them.
All right, how long did it take you?
It took me about 6 months. The design itself took 3 months, and then actually prototyping it took about 3 months.
Hi, my name is Freya Proudman, and I did my study on young women's optimisms for their futures. So the biggest thing that helped me to figure out what I wanted to do was that within the last century, women have gained so many different opportunities, both political, educational opportunities, and even their participation in the workforce has increased. But despite this, a study by Stevenson and Wolfers found that adult women are actually experiencing a decline in happiness, which is really interesting considering you'd think that more opportunities means more happiness, but that wasn't really the case. And other studies done by the Monitoring the Future Foundation found that high schoolers are actually going through a dip in happiness as well. And I wanted to look into this more, and I decided that I was going to test on the younger generation, specifically girls ages 15 through 18. And I wanted to figure out, get a sense of how optimistic they are for their futures, and also what factors they felt restricted them or held them back from getting the futures they want. Because I believe that with this young generation, if we focus on them and we identify the things that hold them back, we can also identify things that help them combat those factors and to get over those things that hold them back so that they can stay optimistic for longer in life and they don't experience that decline in happiness that these adult women are now doing. So I had 17 female volunteers, all ages 15 through 18 years, and they filled out a survey containing 5 different questions that asked them things about their goals in life, how optimistic they ranked themselves on a scale from 1 to 10 about whether or not they could reach those goals, things that held themselves back, why they thought those things, and more. So pretty much I found that young women are actually really optimistic, which is interesting considering the fact that they recognize so many factors that hold themselves back in life. And it's interesting to see that one of the biggest factors girls felt that held them back was actually themselves. So many girls noted that they didn't feel that they would be good enough. They didn't feel that they had the ability to reach their goals in life, which was really sad to hear. But despite this, it's interesting to see that they still are very optimistic that they're going to succeed. So I wanted to look more into that. And I found that a lot of the girls that said that they didn't feel they would succeed, a lot of them identified that they really believed that their future mattered on how hard they worked. And although girls felt that they held themselves back, they believed that they were able to work hard enough to overcome that, to overcome their self-doubt in order to be optimistic and still get the future they wanted for themselves, which was really cool. A lot of girls also identified external factors such as money and opportunities presented them to be things that hold themselves back. The biggest thing that I also saw was society. So many girls talked about how society is actually a thing that holds them back because society pushes for competition between girls. They tell girls that you always have to be the prettiest or the smartest, and they're always pushing for girls to be the better than each other and to compare themselves to each other. And girls mention that this comparison between them and this pressure to be the best is really hurtful because they feel as if they're not the best, then they're not as optimistic about their future because they feel that if they were the best, then they'd be able to have all the chances in life. And so That was really hard to see, and I think that leads a lot to why girls think that they're not good enough, because they're constantly comparing themselves to others. And it really shows that, you know, we need to live in a society where it's great to be the best, but it's more important that girls are their best, their own personal best. So I realized a lot about that, and it was really interesting to see, though. And it's nice to see that, you know, although girls do recognize themselves as a major factor that holds them back, in the end, they're still optimistic. They still believe and they still hope deep down that they're going to be able to succeed later in life.
All right, and how long did this study take you?
I started this study in the fall. I started getting data in about December, and I finished in February. So the data process took me about 2 months or 2 or 3 months or so, but the whole study took me since the beginning of the school year to now.
What I've done here is I've done a study of earthworm regeneration. I was studying not what could be regenerated, because that's already been well studied. What I was studying was how the regeneration process affects worms themselves. So what I did is I tested them on various things or at various intervals to determine, you know, how it changed as they were regenerating. I used the species Lumbricus terrestris. There are many species of earthworms, but I chose this one because it's the most common and it burrows close to the ground. So if you see an earthworm, this is the most likely one to go with. I chose earthworms because while we've studied a lot about planarians and flatworms and other, you know, smaller worms and know a lot about their regeneration, earthworms are much larger and much more complex. And while they can't regenerate as well as like planarians, which can regenerate basically from one cell, they're very complex and much easier to compare to humans. And they can't regenerate all the way, but if we understand the difference between them and flatworms in that they can regenerate a little, we can regenerate even less, and planarians can regenerate a lot, it's a better stepping stone to understand how we could possibly get regeneration of humans in the future. So what I did is I kept them at various intervals, as you can see in this place. I had four groups, a control group, one that was cut here, one that was cut here, and one that was cut here. I put them on either side of the clitellum, which is the band closest to the head, which is where the sexual organs are. It's only present in mature earthworms, and it's usually a good thing to measure things off. I put two on either side of that, and then one close to the tail. Now, the tail is what I'm most interested in. It's not what I'm most interested in, sorry, because past segment 55, full tail regeneration is possible because it's nothing really is happening here. Whereas all the internal organs and important parts are here near the head and near the clitellum. So after I cut them, I was planning to, you know, get data from them every 2 to 3 days. Unfortunately, while I knew that they need a lot of moisture, I didn't know quite how much water they needed. Now, earthworms need a lot of water because they breathe through their skin, and oxygen can't come through the skin unless it's moist. So while I didn't have enough moisture, and they all died early on in the experiment. But
for Amanda's mom,
so they can get moisture from the soil.
Yeah. That's why you see a lot of them dead on the sidewalk after rain. Is because they're looking for darkness and wetness, and they don't realize they're above ground until it stops raining, and then it's too late.
How long did this all take you?
I was planning. So it took me a little while to do the background research and acquire the worms. I actually started experimenting on February 7th, but it was on February 15th that they were all found dead, so I can only gather data once between them.
Hi, my name is Hirtesh, and today I'm going to be talking to you about my project. It's on biofuels. So sooner or later, our world is going to run out of fossil fuels, and we need to find something that can replace them so we can produce our electricity. So my project's on biofuels, and biofuels are recently dead plants, which are gonna need to be replaced. They are automatically replaced because we can keep growing them. And so what I did, I wanted to measure how much it heats up water and also how much carbon dioxide is released. So what I did is I created the biofuels, and once I created it, I also got another product with it, glycerin. Glycerin could be used in many other items, but on biofuels right now, I burned it to see how much temperature change it created with water. I found out that olive oil was the most effective. I also burned it to see how much carbon dioxide was released, and I saw that olive oil released the most carbon dioxide. But when compared to fossil fuels, it released 12%, much less. So, from my analysis, the best possible fuel for biofuel is olive oil.
How long did this take you, this research?
The research, my background research, I took at least like 1.5 hours so I can understand what everything is. Then I spent take my project actually like doing the experiment took about 3 hours. And after that, I looked at all my data and analyzed it and took like 13 hours to get this poster in shape.
HCAM News is supported by our viewers and by Hopkinton Drug, located in this historic New England town since 1954. They are a multifaceted store dedicated to providing clients with an array of healthcare options.
And by Webster First Federal Credit Union, providing financial products with attentive customer service to the local families and businesses of Hopkinton. Visit us at WebsterFirst.com.
Hi, my name is Margie Wiggin, and I want to invite you to join me for my new show, Character Matters, on HCAM. We're going to talk about why do people choose the behavior that they choose? Why do they choose to be good? We're going to hear from people in history. We're going to hear from local heroes who make great choices. And we're going to hear from some puppets who talk about things they've seen. And they're going to say, what? Did you see that? Yes, I did. Please join us.
Have you ever considered texting and driving? If so, you should know the consequences. If caught texting and driving for the first time, you could get an $100 fine plus your license taken away for 60 days. The consequences only get worse the more you get caught. Even if you don't get caught, there could be serious effects. You could get into a car accident and hurt yourself or someone else. Texting and driving is a very dangerous combination, so stop before this happens to you.
Welcome back to HCAM News. Before the break, we showed you some highlights of the annual Hopkinton High School Science and Engineering Fair. Here is a look at some more of the great projects, as well as the 12 winning projects that qualified for the regional science fair.
Okay, all right, so what we're gonna do first is there was a tie for third. So, I know, extra drama this year. All right.
Drum roll.
So, we are going to announce the projects that came in 5th through 12th in random order. We will share with you the comments the judges gave. We'll get those to you in the next couple of days. But we are not going to give the places there, and we're not going to give the scores there, because things change a lot between here and regionals. And frankly, even the project that's 10th here can win a project at regionals, because we are such a strong school. Right, going into regionals. So Ms. Balda's gonna announce the places for 5th through 12th in random order. When it is announced, you can come up and we'll get you the packet. Ms. Noblet's gonna give you
the
packet.
I'll be in charge of the packets.
All right, and then we will do 3rd, 2nd, and the first place award for this year.
No particular order. The first person that is going to regionals is Ashley Nee with the Association of Smell and Memory Impairment. Congratulations. The next project is a group project with Parima Sharma and Bronwyn Pappas Byers, development of solar cells using conductive glass. Good job. Okay, the next project is for Will Lambert, distracted driver detector using webcam. The next person going to regionals is Elon Rosen using a directional lighting network to aid in fire escape. Okay, the next person is Maria Tartaglioni, the effect of ocean acidification on American lobsters. Thank you for that one. The next project goes to Hertesh Rajanagan, which biofuel is best. Woo! The next group going to regionals is Alexa Binock, Sarah Cahill, and Eva Curavilla, finding effective biodegradable alternatives to plastic. Woo!
Congratulations. Great job.
Okay, and the next person going to regionals is A. Neen, harvesting piezoelectricity for everyday use. So the first third place project is going to go to Freya Proudman, Young Women's Optimism for their future.
Right, so we have checks and gift for the HPTA, so the third. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And a trophy.
And our other third place project is going to go to Kate and Emma for the effect of global warming on spider silk protein. Project goes to Brian Best, Music Math. Does music follow the Zipfian distribution?
Great job, Brian. Yeah, let Mom get a good picture there. Got it, Mom?
Oh, wait.
No.
Yeah. I wasn't paying attention, apparently. Thank you.
Okay, and our first place project this year goes to Himanshu Minosha, campus safety warning and notification.
We can have the 12 regional contestants stay. We're going to take a couple of pictures and go through some final things. Other than that, you are free to go. Congratulations again.
Hi, my name is Freya Proudman, and I did my study on young women's optimisms for their futures.
So for our project, we did the durability of long-lasting lipstick.
So I'm Abby Kelly Lancer, and I did my science fair project on music and language. I wanted to find the relationship between the two.
What I've done here is I've done a study of earthworm regeneration. I was studying not what could be regenerated, because that's already been well studied. What I was studying was how the regeneration process affects worms themselves.
Hi, my name is Hritesh, and today I'm going to be talking to you about my project. It's on biofuels. So sooner or later, our world is going to run out of fossil fuels, and we need to find something that can replace them so we can produce our electricity.
So my project this year revolved around trying to create an automatic hand washing machine.
I've been here now for 11 years. I've seen 11 different science fairs. And I think this might be, as a collective group, the best one that I've seen.
No particular order. The first person that is going to regionals is Ashley Nee with the Association of Smell and Memory Impairments. This project is a group project with Parima Sharma and Bronwyn Pappas-Byers, development of solar cells using conductive glass. Okay, the next project is for Will Lambert, distracted driver detector using webcam. Elon Rosen using a directional lighting network to aid in fire. The next person is Maria Tartaglioni. The effect of ocean acidification on American lobsters. Thank you for that one. The next project goes to Hritesh Rajanagan, which biofuel is best. Okay, the next group going to regionals is Alexa Binock, Sarah Cahill, and Eva Curavilla, finding effective biodegradable alternatives to plastic. The next person going to regionals is A. Neen, harvesting piezoelectricity for everyday use. So we have a tie for third place. So the first third place project is going to go to Freya Proudman, Young Women's Optimism for their future. The other third place project is going to go to Kate and Emma for the effect of global warming on spider silk protein. All right, in second place, this project goes to Brian Best, Music Math. Does music follow the Zipfian distribution? First place project this year goes to Himanshu Minosha, campus safety warning and notification.
For more from the Hopkinton High School Science and Engineering Fair, head over to our website, hcam.tv. That will just about do it for this edition of HCAM News. Don't forget, you can stay up to date with everything Hopkinton by checking out our website, hcam.tv, as well as our Twitter and Facebook page. Right now on our website, hcam.tv, you can view the latest in Hiller's sports and more from the Hopkinton High School Science and Engineering Fair. If you have a Hopkinton-related video, photo, or story idea, I want to hear from you. Email me at news@hcam.tv. With your help, we'll cover even more of our community. For everyone here at HCAM, I'm Tom Nappy. Take care, and as always, thanks for watching HCAM.
Smile has gone.